Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Stinking Gecko podcast, where we talk about our household reptiles. And
why'd you have to take it there?
I don't know.
It's bathroom humor Andy over here.
That's not bathroom. That's what kind of humor is that? I don't know. Stinking reptile humor. That's funny.
Off to a great start over here on episode 29.
Yes. And we have my friend, and I suppose Josh's friend too, Dave, Mr. Dave Mantel. Say hello, Dave.
What's up?
I'm doing really well over here.
That's awesome. You got to say my name right, though. You got the
Dave Mantel? Last
name. Mantel.
Mantel. Yeah. Man. Oh, not Mon. It's Man.
Yeah.
Okay.
Dave is kind of the original good boy here. I mean, he was an early adopter.
The OGGB.
OGG.
I love it.
Precisely, yeah. And Dave's going to join us for the whole dang show, the whole doggone show.
We're comfortable enough with Dave that, yes, we're going to allow that to happen this time. And we expect a lot from you, Dave.
I'm here. I'm ready to please. The pressure, I feel like the bar is set pretty high, but... Okay, you know, I'm willing to rise to the challenge.
Great. So here's what we're expecting from you. We're expecting one-liners.
Uh-huh.
We're expecting you to interrupt things and throw everything into disarray.
Great.
And generally for you to just kind of troll us, because that seems to be what you do online for the most part.
Listen, man, I'll tell you what. I've been preparing my whole life for this, and I think I can make that happen. Yeah.
You're my favorite troll. I've had multiple... You've commented on my YouTube videos a lot, and people think you're serious and get mad at you.
Yeah. There's this thing on the internet called Poe's Law, and it's... it means...
Like Poe? Edgar Allan Poe?
No, it doesn't have anything to do with Edgar Allan. But so Poe's Law says that in an argument or anywhere online that there's a discussion, someone will make a comment and it'll be a facetious comment, but someone will take it seriously and an argument will ensue. And okay. I feel like I am that person in your life.
Yeah, you definitely are. And I appreciate it.
I never heard of that law. I just learned something today. Excellent.
Cool. Well, thanks for joining us here on the Ink and Echo podcast, everybody. We'll see you next week.
Yeah. Good one, guys. Nailed it. Shortest episode.
Yeah. All right.
Go ahead.
So we're recording this Saturday before it comes out. So two things. I don't want to edit this damn thing, guys. So don't fuck anything up. Uh-huh. Okay.
Oh, can we edit that out? Edit that F word out there. Ding.
So that's one. And two, my kids are downstairs watching Finding Dory. So if you ever hear any kids or, you know, Dory noises, that's what's happening. I'm supposed to be watching my kids right now, but instead I'm drinking a beer and doing a podcast. Why would I say watching a podcast? That doesn't even ever happen anyway.
I guess even as a father, it is hashtag sans Andy. Does that make sense?
Wow.
I mean, that was pretty good, right?
That was amazing.
Wait, you got to explain that one a little bit.
Well, I should let Dave explain it.
Yeah.
I have what to explain this? yeah. On the internet, was on Twitter, right? When the show started, I started a hashtag for the show. This is when I had a public Twitter profile, which I no longer do because of this show, actually. We can talk about that later, but so I started a hashtag called Sans Andy, and I just had an opinion that maybe the show would be better hashtag Sans Andy.
Andy.
Little more professional.
Amen.
Now Josh, in this very moment, has brought things to a much darker place and implied
he's brought it into my family life.
I feel like maybe your kids and I might have a heart to heart about this, you know, and like talk about what life would be like. Yeah, Andy.
You could all just dream about it. It'd be like a reverse It's a Wonderful Life. Like
it
instead
sounds
of
like
me
they don't
wondering
have to dream about it.
Oh God. Yeah. But it's a reverse. It's a Wonderful Life. So instead of me assuming that life would have been better off with me gone, it's just everyone else is assuming that.
Everyone else is just like, wow, what if we got rid of that asshole?
So oh my gosh. We should explain to our listeners maybe like how Dave, you and Andy know each other and why you get to be one of the extra special people that gets come on the entire show.
Why don't you deserve this?
Why don't you explain that, Andy?
Well, here's what I remember. This is going to take both of us to figure it out. So
I
met you in person first. So it was 2012. I was on tour with Future of Forestry, the Christmas tour. So it was December. And I believe you came to the Wisconsin show because you lived in Wisconsin at the time. Is that right?
I did, yeah.
And then, but I don't remember what the lead up was, because we had one of those weird online friendships that I don't make with people anymore because I'm not online as much anymore.
Yeah, no, I was actually thinking about this too recently. I was like, man, because that was the first time that we met in person, but I know that we at least talked online before that, and that it was enough, like we had enough of a rapport for me to like tweet at you or whatever and be like, hey, I'm going to come to your show. We should hang out. And then we did.
And Andy actually replied, unlike anyone else ever. Yeah.
Shut up.
This is an ancient time, man. Like this is like
back when I was actually a good boy.
I mean, all he wanted to do on Twitter, Andy.
All he wanted to do was talk about gear and like all the pedals that he had.
100% different person, wasn't I?
Yeah. But yeah, that was when we met. Was that tour?
Yeah, and you were the cool guy who stuck around for like the whole thing, even through loadout. You were like rolling amps out for us and stuff.
Yeah,
they were always like, oh, geez, who's this guy that's sticking around? Gosh, wish he would leave already.
Yeah. So I had to move some heavy stuff to like show that I could stay around. They're like, all right, we'll let him stay.
And one thing I remember specifically about that show, it doesn't relate to anything we're talking about, but they had a bunch of Diet Coke liter bottles. And so we just took them all and used them for mixing with Jack Daniels in the bus. In this church parking lot.
That'll do it. I mean, watching your calories while you get blazed. That's great. Yeah.
Exactly. Well, that's supposedly a thing. Like Diet Coke and Jack is
better than
like anything else for some reason. I was with a bunch of people who knew all of those things. I didn't. It's like, okay, cool. But I'm happy to take church soda and turn it into a cocktail. That's fine.
Did with at least one of the liter bottles, did you just like take off the top and put your thumb over it and shake it around and like spray each other and like jump in slow motion.
The stickiest
Diet Coke
tour bus.
Wet t-shirts.
We had a wet Diet Coke, a wet t-shirt contest with Diet Coke on an RV in a church parking lot.
With all males who had just played worship music. It was great.
Josh, were you there? Did you, how did you know that happened?
Oh, I sent him the private video.
Right, oh, right. Yeah. Okay.
They did the same thing at the Colorado Springs show. So.
Oh yeah, that was a nightly occurrence. The wet t-shirt party with soda.
Here, I thought I was witnessing like a once in a lifetime opportunity. You guys were doing that every night.
Oh yeah, man, rock star life style. You know, I'm all about it.
Anyway, this is ridiculous.
Dave, I feel like you were both into ambient guitar, right? Liz, that's kind of how it started.
I think that's how it started, yeah.
Yeah. And then maybe we should do this. So what has happened to you since then? There's been a lot. Okay. So here's what I know about you. You make your own music. You had or still have a record label that you're running. You had a podcast for a while.
Mm-hmm.
You record and engineer other people. You play in a band that does some touring, correct? Am I correct in all of those things so far?
Yeah.
Okay. And how many of those things are you still doing to this day?
Everything except for the podcast are things that I do.
And the funny thing about your podcast is the last person you tried to book was Josh, right? Before you quit.
I had
it was
well,
actually
yeah,
me
we
email begging him to come on. Yeah.
Oh, really?
It was, oh man, I'm so glad we get to talk about this finally. Because I owe Josh an apology, I think.
All right.
Because,
let's do it.
I totally understand. No,
because here's what happened. What happened was, I was doing this podcast and it was going really well and I was meeting a lot of cool people, and my statistics were like, if you looked at the subscriber amount, it was just like a 90 degree angle, you know, like people were just like every week, it was like so many people on. Oh man, hundreds of millions of people were listening to it. I was like gonna be up there with WTF.
Oh yeah.
And yeah, so
Marin
then
and
Josh,
Hardwick and Mantel, that's what it was gonna be.
It was gonna be that, yeah. And Josh sent me an email and he's like, hey, I'm friends with Andy and I write books. Can I come on your show? And I was like, oh, okay, cool. Yeah, that sounds good. And then I had a nervous breakdown and I quit doing my show. So
There was just too much money coming in, too much fame.
Too much of like a high profile thing. Situation.
Right.
Yeah.
So let's just start there. Was the nervous breakdown about? If I mean, as much as you are willing to share.
Sure. Yeah.
Share it all.
I have dealt with some of the things you guys talk about on the show a lot. Anxiety and depression have been very prevalent in my life. Mm-hmm. And I think my depression is situational depression. So I like get into places in life and I have anxiety because of things that happen, and that leads to depression and anxiety mm-hmm. attacks. And so I happened to I was working a job that was really rough on me mentally, that I hated. It was probably the second worst job I've had. And
was this, can I make a conjecture as to the job?
Sure.
Was it the youth group job at that time?
No.
Post youth group?
Yeah. So I was an assistant pastor for a little bit, but this is after that.
Okay. So what was this job?
I was working a job in sales. I was selling. It was bad. I was on the phone all day talking to CEOs of companies and CFOs that didn't want to talk to me.
Fun.
So I was trying to do that and do this podcast and do music stuff. And I had a couple of episodes that I did in a row that were like kind of train wreck episodes. And I just
not
was
mine,
like,
right? Mine was
no. Andy was on the show a couple of times, and
oh yeah,
wait, was it was that train wreck in your own assessment, or people responded poorly to them?
Like, okay, so I had I felt like the show when I would interview people was generally positive, and mm-hmm. even people that I would bring on the show that I didn't know beforehand. Mm-hmm. I would have conversations with them, and you know, like I'm sure you guys have experienced this too. You have people on your show and you're like, wow, this is really cool that we get this person on the show. Mm-hmm. And then you have a conversation with them and you're like, wow, that was really cool. Like we got to talk about some things and it went generally well. Mm-hmm. And, I feel okay publishing this. I had a couple in a row with people that, I didn't know, that I had agreed to do my show. And I asked, you know, I had, the format at my show was a little more like conversational. It wasn't like I had a list of questions to ask everybody.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And these people that had agreed to do my show, like, just didn't, they weren't into it. So, like, I would be asking questions and then they were treating me like not a human person. And they're like, why are you asking these questions? Like, I'm just going to tell you nonsense.
They weren't prepared for to try to go deeper kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah. And I was just like, it was a combination of that happening and like taking a couple weeks and being like, well, okay, I don't have an episode this week because this interview went really bad. And then
so you didn't
anxiety.
Even put those out?
No.
Okay.
They don't exist. Yeah. So it's just a lot of things. And then, I had this like kind of breakdown, I had to make some evaluations of things in my life where I was like, what do I need to put aside and what do I need to focus on? And the podcast just like hit the back burner and I never picked it up again.
So what did the breakdown actually physically or whatever look like? I mean, for you, was it total anxiety or total depression or both or what?
Yeah, it's hard to pinpoint it. It was a while ago, and I've had so many. but usually, what happens for me is like I'll get into I'll have like a panic attack, and then so that basically just looks like I'll be thinking about something like a problem, and then I can't stop thinking about that problem, and it's like a feedback loop, right? Where like I start worrying about the thing, and it's a thing that I don't have any control over. And then I'm like, well, I don't have any control over it. And I'm like, but why don't I have control over it? And then I like freak myself out, right? And that usually leads to, once that passes, the initial panic attack, at my worst, I would just like not get out of bed for a couple of days. I've been really good recently. I haven't been like that for a while, but yeah, at my worst, that's what it was.
Do you have any thoughts as to why you haven't experienced that recently?
I've made a lot of positive life changes. That's it's a lame phrase, I saw the patterns that I was creating for myself and have worked hard to not put myself in those situations and to be proactive. So like I practice mindfulness and meditation, and I get better sleep now and I eat better. Just little things that can make a really big difference. I talked a lot, you know, I haven't gone to therapy, which I think is just it's a pride thing, it's a money thing, you know, but I think that people that deal with this kind of stuff, if you can, you should go to therapy. A lot of my friends go to therapy and they have really benefited from it. You know, if you need meds, get meds. But I have found good people in my life that I can talk to about stuff like this, and so that's helped.
Yeah, I was just gonna ask if through any of that, if you had a close friend or anyone who was aware of kind of how dark you went sometimes and how down you were, because you're not married, is that correct?
Nope, single.
Okay,
living the single life.
And were you in a relationship through any of that, those periods, or?
No, I wasn't.
Okay. So just that was curious, because that's like the most, you know, that's the first direct person to go to. But anyway, back to the question, like, did you have friends through that time or not necessarily?
Yeah, I'm really lucky. I have a lot of, or not a lot, but I have a close knit group of friends that I feel like I can talk about this stuff with, that these are people that have dealt with mental illness as well, you know, depression, anxiety, all kinds of things, bipolar. And so I think the most important thing for me is like, not that people give me advice, because that's not really what I'm looking for, is just, what I need for myself is just to be heard, you know, where I'm like, oh man, this really sucks right now. And for someone to say, yeah, that really does suck, and I'm really sorry for that, you know, and then that's all. But people who don't understand are like, well, why don't you try and fix that? Why don't you do this and this and this? Like, I don't need that
helpful.
Right now.
Yeah.
I feel like, and maybe, surely this is still a thing, but there's that, and I don't know if this is, you know, if you could qualify this as like sexist or something, but you always hear the thing like men want solutions and women just want to be heard kind of thing. But the more and more I talk to people about this stuff, it seems like more often than not, everyone just wants to be heard and not necessarily given a solution. Like, that's not just a men versus women thing. Like, I've talked to so many guy friends who are like, I don't want a solution. I just want a person to listen or talk to. Right. It's just interesting, because I feel like I've been told for so long that that's how women are, and it wasn't, you know, men are supposed to be like the, oh, well, I here's a solution, and here I'm fixing myself and fixing you and fixing everybody. But it's just, I don't think that's true anymore or even a thing that ever was, you know?
Yeah. I think even I've come to believe it breaks down to oftentimes creative people in particular or type fours mm-hmm. and fives on the Enneagram are much more tend to be, regardless of gender, kind of those wanna be heard.
Yeah.
Where there's definitely other personality types that are asking yeah. for a solution. But the three of us present, yeah, I think we all probably just want to be heard and get our crazy thoughts out and then at least have someone tell us like, hey, that's not true. You should stop thinking that.
Right.
Like stop dwelling yeah. on that.
Have you done the Enneagram, Dave?
I have, and I was just about to ask, what are you guys' numbers?
Four wing five, motherfucker. It's the, I mean, that's true, but it's four wing five is, it's like an incredible blessing, and I want to die a lot.
Yeah, and I've done the test twice, and the first time I got a four wing five, and the second time I got a five wing four. So the part about fives, which is the energy thing, like, you know, just I gain energy by being alone and lose it quickly by being with people. That's like one of my big characteristics.
Sure.
But a lot of stuff with the four, I'm like, I see myself as like right in between those two for sure.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And you, good sir?
I'm a four also, which is interesting. Hey. I don't know what my wing is. But I'm definitely a four.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. The wing tends to be just like the second highest ranking number. And
I'm probably a five.
Well, so, five. But if you're a four, can't your wing only be three or five? Isn't that how it works?
That
you can't be a four wing seven or something.
Oh, that like, may I'm pretty be sure. I'm not familiar enough, but
I'm pretty sure it's set up in a circle so that if, you know, if you're a one, you're a one wing two or nine. Like it kind of, I think that's, maybe I'm wrong. I thought that's how it was set up.
What I am familiar with is the stress and health thing. Mm. You guys, is that related right. to the wing?
No, I don't
think
so.
That's a different, that's like you go to a certain number when you're healthy, you look more like a certain number. And when you're under stress, you look more like a very different number.
But see, I pretend like I know what I'm talking about. I had a whole episode on my podcast about Enneagram, and now it's the truth is that I really don't know anything about it.
Hey, neither do us. Okay.
Yeah, neither do us. We also speak good.
We're not going to edit this podcast. Woo!
No. Geez.
But I love that stuff. It's kind of been very prevalent in the past year of my life, and I mean, both through counseling and even through some friends at church, but just on a very base level, it kind of seems to help at least me understand myself and my tendencies and also understand other people better that
right.
other people aren't out to get me and they're not necessarily always assholes, but they're just unaware of how they affect type fours.
Right.
Sure.
Anyway.
Wait, so Josh, we mentioned therapy a minute ago, and I know you did that counseling for a while. Would you consider that therapy, or is that something different?
Yeah.
And
yeah,
how totally. Long did you do that for?
That was only a 6-week stint.
Okay.
And yeah, it was primarily for depression and anxiety, and we ended up spending a lot of time on the Enneagram. It just happened to be what this particular counselor uses a lot. But that was hugely helpful, even to the point that we went on the Enneagram website and watched videos of interviews with people who are type fours. And, you know,
right.
about 85% of it I resonated with. And these were all people in their 40s or 50s. So it's kind of seeing possible future version of myself that has learned to operate in a healthy way right. with this number. And I wish I had known it when I was 18, because I was just such a emotional disaster and really did not know how to deal with certain situations well. Anyway, yeah. Not to make that about me, I'd like to get back to Dave, but
well, yeah, me too, please.
Wait, so Dave, would you ever consider going back to your podcast? And I ask that because I feel like I mean, I have a similar thing in the sense that when we first started this podcast, I like was having sort of panic attacks, breakdown things, and that's why we didn't start it. But the way it's going now, it feels very cathartic to me and like a good thing for me. And I've been able to get some things out that I don't think I would have been comfortable talking about had I not been doing this. So do you ever consider doing something either the same as what you're doing before or in a different way that would be good for you?
Yeah, I've thought about it. I have people ask me that all the time. Well, that makes it sound like it was a bigger deal than it was.
I mean, you had 100 million listeners. I do listeners. Have
100 million, said. Yeah.
Yeah.
no, I've thought about it. I think if I were to do it again, I wouldn't want to do it by myself. I might host it by myself, but like, it's just a lot to do a weekly podcast with a guest and like do all of the recording, all of the booking, and all of the editing and posting and stuff on top of everything else that I was trying to do. It was just like, I was biting off a lot more than I could chew, I think. And like to clarify, like that doing that show was amazing. I learned a lot about myself. I met a lot of really cool people that I still keep in contact with because of that show. And I know that people talk to me about that, about the content that I like covered. So the show is basically highlighting independent art and artists and like DIY culture and stuff that I am kind of deeply rooted in and just like creativity in general.
Yeah.
And people have had conversations with me about how the things that I talked about helped them give voice to things that they might not have been able to otherwise.
And
I'm really grateful for all of that. And I think that there is a lot more to talk about in that. That conversation, but to do it alone, is not something that I really want to do. So who knows what the future holds, you know? Maybe somebody else will pick up the torch. Maybe, I'll meet somebody in the future that's like, oh, hey, I want to help, you know, do this or whatever. Right. Or maybe I'll just have a bunch of free time sometime. We'll see.
Yeah.
Well, that's funny because,
go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, it's just funny because the way Josh and I say it, and we've said it a couple times, it's like we got pretty lucky in the sense that we've split up roles, but we both really enjoy the things that we do. So with me doing the engineering and editing and posting, I really like that. And I would never in a million years want to be the one sending booking emails and stuff. And Josh does a really good job at that and seems to enjoy it. So we got somewhat lucky with that dynamic here.
Yeah. And even on the, I mean, it helps with being regular and being sort of accountable to keep doing it every week, but also like the interview thing you mentioned earlier, I feel like Andy has saved some interviews that have almost gone awry and vice versa, I would say, with guests where not necessarily it was going to go to train wreck, but the conversation was really hard to get rolling. And it's super vulnerable to be on a mic by yourself with somebody on Skype you've never met.
Yeah, absolutely.
So anyway, all that to say, I think a partner who you really jived with would help a lot.
Yep.
So, and I'll just say, over the past 7 months, Andy is a totally different guy than when we started this. He has opened up so much and loosened up, sort of on the things that you had anxiety about, Andy, and, you know, we're scared to like talk about. And
there were all these things where I was like, I don't want to go here. I don't want to go here. And now I don't care about those things. I mean, I don't care about not going there anymore, which is, feels very good to not have
been
those.
It's been interesting for me personally, like as someone who started listening early on, just because I was like, oh, Andy's doing this thing with this guy that sent me an email one time. I should probably listen to that. But it's been interesting for me because the things that you have been talking about, Andy specifically, you know, and then I'll listen to an episode and then we'll text about some of the things that you talked about and have other conversations. And I think that that's been really cool for me to... I guess what I should say is the vulnerability that you've shown doing this show has been encouraging to me. And I think that it's, I'll speak for myself. I think it's helped our friendship, and
yeah,
the conversations that we've had have been good for me to have, you know what I mean?
Yeah, because there were things we talked about. I was like, oh, I didn't really know that you were on that level of that, or that we were that closely aligned on certain things.
So, sure, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So I don't know where we want to go from here. There's so many places we could go. Where should we go?
Well,
now?
Guys, thanks for listening to the Ink and Echo podcast. Join us next time.
We'll just have a bunch of false endings and play the music. So Dave, I would love to know about the fact that you used to work for a church and you now no longer believe in God, correct?
Yeah, no, I'm an atheist.
All actually, right. Let's hit it.
Anti-deist.
So you are funny because I don't know if you're joking or not.
Yeah, that's my secret.
I know.
You're a wild card.
Your sarcasm is so good. So props to you.
I grew up in a house where my dad's love language is sarcasms, and I like inherited that, and it's gotten me into trouble my whole life. So,
but also probably got some good laughs here and there.
Here and there. Yeah. So, what do you want to do? You want to just hear the story?
Yeah. Okay. Let's hear the whole thing.
All right. Story time with Dave Mantel.
Yeah. Let's see. I haven't really talked about this story in any kind of public setting. So, breaking news.
Hey, we got a exclusive.
I grew up in the church. My dad is a pastor now. He's a youth pastor when I was in high school. So that should give you some kind of idea of like my adolescence anyway.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What was the denomination?
I grew up in a church called the Salvation Army, which is the thrift store.
The
Salvation Army. Yeah, it's a thrift store, but it's also a church, which is not widely known.
Yeah, I didn't know that for a long time.
Yeah,
yeah.
So that was a denomination I grew up in. It's it's related to the Methodist movement, so like holiness tradition, evangelical, blah blah blah. So I grew up there, and in 2010 I dropped out of college to take an internship in Michigan doing urban mission work, which is a fancy way of saying I moved into a crappy part of town to work at a church with some people and be in this crappy neighborhood purposefully and like make relationships with people. And
so let me just interject real quick. Looking back at that time, do you think at the time was your heart in it, or was it like an obligation thing, or maybe thing?
I was totally in it.
You were sold. Like, okay.
I had in college read The Irresistible Revolution by Shane Claiborne, and I was like, this is it. This guy has dreadlocks. And he tells me that I don't have to be a Republican to be a Christian. My mind was so full of new ideas.
See, that's how it starts. See what happens?
This is what happens.
When you go liberal?
Well, let me tell you the rest of the story, Andrew. So I worked in this internship for a year with these people. From that internship, then I got a job as a full-time assistant pastor at another church in Wisconsin.
And what age was this? Were you?
I was 21.
Dang, that's young to be an assistant pastor.
You're telling me. So I get this job as assistant pastor, and I live in this house with a guy who's hired at the same time to be the youth pastor of the church, and we're both. He's a year younger than me, so he's 20. I'm 21.
Wow.
And we're, excuse me, we're together. Two-thirds of the ministry team at this church. And I worked there for 2 years. And during those 2 years, I was reading a lot of books. I was doing a lot of things that I had never done before, you know, in ministry, as I was in charge of a lot of people's well-being spiritually. And it was a lot of pressure for a 21, 22, 23-year-old.
Absolutely.
And so as I'm like working in this church, I'm reading these books and reading the Bible, and my understanding of who God is starting to change. And then all at once, my dad's parents both die, my grandma and my grandpa, who I was pretty mm-hmm. close with. And the people who, my friends who I had lived with in Michigan, that were part of this discipleship program, when I moved in with them, they had just had a baby daughter. Her name is Hannah. And she, when I moved in with them, she was 3 months old. And so I lived with them and saw her take her first steps and say her first words and stuff. And these guys became like my second family, and it was great. And so right before I had left to go take this assistant pastor position, they had said, "Hey, we're pregnant again. We're gonna have another kid." And I was like, "Oh, that's so awesome! You know, you guys are gonna have another kid that I will love, and it'll be amazing." And so I moved to this other church, and I'm working there, and my grandparents both die. And then their newborn daughter dies.
After birth?
She had heart complications, and so she was born and with these heart complications and lived just a couple of hours before she died. And so that was, it was really jarring. All of this happens within 2 or 3 months. It was in December. Because I remember driving around doing work in the snow, and all I could think about was all this stuff going on, and thinking to myself, like, what? Okay, on the one hand, my grandparents are old and they've lived full lives.
Yeah,
it's a natural part of the cycle for them to die, right?
Sure. Yeah.
And it hurts, and you know, all the emotions that go along with that, but I can understand it. This, on the other hand, my friend's daughter dying, that didn't seem fair to me. And it was like, this is not natural, right? And what kind of God? And, you know, those are the questions that I'm dealing with.
Were you able to talk? I mean, so as the assistant pastor at the time, were there people you could go to with this stuff? Because I've heard so many stories of people being in those positions and just not having to be that person for everyone else and no one being it for them. Did you experience that or not really?
Not really. The icing on the cake was that right about the same time, the pastors that had hired me, the couple that had hired me at this church moved, and we got new pastors at this church. So here are these new people, and I'm dealing with all of this stuff. These new people come in and they're like, you know, that I'm like, there's no one I can really talk to about this stuff other than friends of mine. And, you know, bad will towards my friends, obviously,
sure.
But it's like, there's just some things that you go through that people don't know how to react to, or the things that I'm dealing with in my mind are too big to really verbalize. And so any kind of conversation that I have is not really going to be the whole picture, right? This is what I was dealing with. So then I go on this, like, this search for ultimate truth. I like read more. I have to figure out what I believe about everything, because my whole worldview is shattered because, you know, who knows why. It was just the way that it was. Yeah. And as my worldview shifts, I'm still having to do Bible studies and like preach and lead music on Sundays and do all of these things and like pretend like everything is normal. Or at least this is the perception that I have, is like, I can't talk about this with people because I don't know what I believe anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah. And in the end, I couldn't take that. I felt like I was being dishonest, and that it was too much for me. And so I just quit And I moved to North Carolina to try and run away from my problems. I moved in with my friends whose daughter had died. We just kind of, I went through a period of just kind of like detox. And when I moved there, I had
Detox from what?
From God, from the church, from pain. I think when I got there, I was sort of like, I don't want anything. I left with a bad taste in my mouth, you know, and I think a lot of that I associated with God and with the church. And so I just went and I stopped going to church and worked at Target and made some music and hung out with my friends. Yeah. And that was an interesting period in my life. I just kind of let go of everything that I had grown up with. And it's really strange to go from from being a full-time pastor to not going to church at all or even caring about it.
Yeah.
Right.
So I am curious, and you can continue, but just living with your friends, how did they sort of, I mean, I'm assuming they were still Christians. How did they deal with the death of their new child and sort of, you know, since you were around for very near to that?
Yeah. I think it was hard. I think we all felt it in different ways, you know, and I obviously, I can't compare the things that I was going through with what they went through, and I'm not trying to. But it, I think it was good for us to be together because we could at least talk to each other about things.
Right.
That was kind of how I felt, was like, and why I ended up moving back in with them was like, you guys are the only people that I can like, that know what's going on, you know, and like that I could be open about things with, or, you know, whatever. And so we would talk a lot about, faith and religion and things. And, that was, enormously helpful. I think that, being able to be on the same level with this kind of stuff. And, you know, we're all reading books and trying to cope in different ways. And like, hey, you know, like, what do you think about this idea or this idea? And, that was, it was like almost, getting back to normal in a sense, like, and I think that that really helped, for where I was.
Overall, a healthy period, would you say, like in contrast to, to having just worked for that church that was not a healthy
environment? Yeah, I think it was something I really needed, was just a time to like let go. Deconstruction is a term I hear a lot recently. It's like a buzzword for people who would consider themselves like post-evangelical or like post-Christian even. They're like, oh yeah, I'm in this time of deconstruction of my faith or whatever. And I hear that on the Liturgist podcast a lot.
Yeah.
And I think that that's what that period was for me, was I just took a period of time where I took everything and let go and started to one by one maybe pick up the things to like rebuild a worldview or a faith system. And I'll be honest, like at the beginning that didn't really involve much of Christianity. It was just like, let me find a little bit of hope, you know, or like something. Because when you come in, like for me, it was like I never experienced death that closely, and to have all that happen at once, I needed to I needed to like really change the way I thought about the world and who God was. And
did you have anyone trying to rationalize it for you or give you some sort of argument as to why early, you know, try to explain why a God might exist, but that could still happen? And if so, how did you feel or respond to those things?
It's hard for me to pinpoint if anybody said that to me specifically. And I know that I know that probably did happen. But I let that stuff just roll off me usually because I was like, okay, what, I don't care about any of this, you know, like that's not whatever. But it took me a long time to really find out why I didn't believe in that, if that makes sense. So like I that was something I was very aware of from the outside, from people who, I just knew that that was an idea that like everything happens for a purpose and God makes everything happen. And so when people die and like injustice happens, God has a plan and he's going to work through it, you know? And it's like,
right.
That's easy to say when things are fine. But as soon as things are not fine, you really have to like, you're either going to have to like really double down on that and be like, okay, yeah, sure. God has everything. You know, he really knows what he's doing here and he's really doing this on purpose for, to strengthen my faith or something, you know, whatever. And, or you, reject that idea of God and find a new one.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So how did you, from North Carolina to now you're in Chicago, what did that period entail and the period of where you were there, in regards to faith, to taking the final step of just like, I'm totally out.
Yeah. Well, spoiler alert, I'm not totally out.
Oh man. Andy, gotcha. Just lead us in a word of prayer here.
I was going to say, yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. No, I'm not totally out, but, I'm not totally in. So we'll get to that somewhere.
Yeah.
I think we might, a line closer than might think, but anyway, so what was I saying? Oh yeah, so like I said earlier, I don't know if I said that while we were recording or not, but I move a lot. I have itchy feet kind of, and so after being in North Carolina for a while, there were some opportunities that came up in Chicago, and a lot of my friends are here, and part of that was music related. And so I came back to start, recording people. Music production is what I do on the side, of my day job.
Nice.
And, some opportunities kind of presented themselves. And, I had just finished recording a double EP for myself, which was like really the first serious recording project that I had ever done. And I found out I really liked it. And, so when these things came up, I was like, okay, I'm going to head back to Chicago and maybe I'll just do this for a while and see what happens. So on January 1, 2013, I think, I moved back to Chicago and, started recording, an album with my friends the next day. And, still didn't go to church. I didn't plan on going to church. I didn't really think much about it. But I really did, love being back with my friends. A lot of them were friends that I grew up with in church. And so, the more time that I spent around them and doing things with them, you know, the conversation would come up and be like, hey man, why don't you come to church? Or like, why don't you do this stuff? And
hey brother, like, why don't you join us? For-
It's it was a lot chiller than that, but essentially that was like how I heard it at the time. I was just like, no, I don't really want to do that. really the thing that did it was this guy I knew, we're friends now, asked me to come to a young adult event that was an area wide thing for our denomination, and he's like, "Hey, can you come to this thing and DJ for me? I'll pay you and stuff." I did some DJing at the time, because who doesn't go through a DJ phase, right? And he was like, "Hey, I can pay you, and like, why don't you just come to this thing?" And I was like, "I really don't want to come to that thing, but you're gonna pay me, and all I have to do is like play some music. That'll be fine, you know. Like, I'll go. I'll see some people that I haven't seen for a little bit." And while I was there, I can't really explain what happened, but I had my heart was softened. It had nothing to do with anything that was happening at the weekend. It didn't have anything to do with that. I was just sitting by myself, not paying attention to what was going on. And something happened inside of me, and I knew that I had to change my attitude towards life, towards whatever God was at the time, you know, whatever I thought of him. I just was like, okay, I'm tired of running away. I need to like start moving in a positive direction towards something that to me meant reconciliation, but to what I didn't really know. And so from that moment, I've been trying, and it's really hard. I don't know anything about anything. I don't really claim to, I definitely don't believe in God the way that I did when I was a pastor. I don't really believe, in that same God, the God that like makes bad things happen to people because he wants to test them or grow them or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But I do believe in Jesus and his teachings, and I think that following those teachings are the best thing that I can do with my life, and I try to do that. Mm-hmm. That's like as much as I have in my life. It's like I could do this. Yeah. I could follow this guy and his teachings and figure it out, you know?
So you feel like there's some pressure still to figure something out, or no?
I think that I think there's a lot that I don't know, that I don't, you know, because I think I constantly compare myself to myself, but earlier, if that makes sure. sense.
Yeah. Where,
like, I think about the me in college. I'm like, man, that dude, he just had he like really believed in things, and he really like thought he had things figured out. And I wish that I could like, I wish I could have those, I wish I could feel things like he felt things, or like that I could be as sure of things as he was.
Yeah.
And instead I find myself in this, this giant land of unknowing. And,
yes.
So on one hand, I desire to be that person that I was at one point, or like to have the same experiences or feelings or whatever. But on the other hand, I don't think that guy knew what he was talking about. He hadn't experienced things in life, and like, who I am now is definitely a more honest person.
Sure.
Definitely. I feel like this is going to sound arrogant, you know, but like, I think that, I am more in touch with, if there is a God, and if that God is, making himself known to humanity, like, I feel like I am know more about him than I did before, because before I believed in a made up version.
Sure.
That was like American and Western and
Republican.
and Republican, and he like had a shotgun, you know, and like whatever. And now,
and white because Jesus was white.
Yeah, totally. Definitely white. I am confident of a lot less, but the things that I do believe are more solid, if that makes sense. I don't know.
Sure. What would you say some of those things are?
Like the nature of God is love. That God doesn't desire for his creation to suffer. That he's knowable, but also that there's no point at which I can know anything about him. It sounds like a lot of New Age bullshit. You know what I mean? Like,
well, are you speaking as like it's more of a one-way thing than a two-way thing? Like,
no.
We can know about, because that, I mean, the whole, when even you mentioned earlier, you said if we can hear from God, which is just so an interesting thing to say. It's like, how can you, it seems like you either hear from something or you don't. And it's like, it's so crazy that we have this question. It's like, we don't know if we're hearing from our creator. That's just, the more I think about it, it just blows my mind. It's like, and it seems to, and this kind of goes for the entire conversation, it's like, if you don't know, how do I want to word this? Like, if you can't prove, but if you can't feel it or hear it, then that seems to be a point for non-belief in my mind.
Totally. I think that makes sense when you're looking at things like when you're looking for empirical evidence of a thing.
Yeah.
You want to be able to touch and hear and smell and feel that thing, right? And the crazy thing for me is that I know that I have encountered something that is greater than myself. But I don't know the nature of that thing. All I know is like, if there is that thing, if what I have experienced is real, he's different than the evangelical white American Jesus God. But he's different because he's bigger and greater than that, you know? And I keep saying he, but it's a filler. Just to clarify. I think that I've been reading this book by Carl Sagan called Pale Blue Dot, which is like, it's amazing. When I look at, the caveat is that he sees things in the world and says this is a case for there not to be a creator. And I look at the same evidence and I'm like, oh man, but doesn't that like show you that there's purpose in the universe? And like, it doesn't, I think he's like very averse to the Judeo-Christian or like, you know, like whatever Yahweh, Old Testament God. And that's fine because I'm also averse to that. But there are things in the world that just scream to me that like, we have purpose. This is getting like way, this is weirder perfect than I thought it was going to be. Can one of you guys talk for a little bit, please?
Okay,
Jesus Christ.
Well, that's been the Ink and Echo podcast.
Okay, I have something to share. So, Dave, I resonate with a lot of what you're saying because I, in the past, I don't know, probably 6 months, have experienced more doubt and uncertainty than ever. And in a very, well, I've always had doubt probably since age 16 or so, but in a different sense, to where this is lately has been the culmination of just being like, wait a minute, this does not add up.
Yeah.
And at no point have I gone to the point of saying I don't believe in at least God or Jesus or there being some deity who I too feel like I have had moments of just sensing that there is something far greater than myself. But okay, this has a few different facets, but so
this is hard. It's so hard to talk about. I always listen to like Dave Bazan talk about this stuff, and I'm like, man, he's so articulate with how he feels about things. And I'm like, I could totally do that. And then here we are, and I've just rambled for an hour.
Yeah, it's a challenge. Sorry, I had two thoughts, which were one that my uncertainty has grown so much since having a child, which Andy maybe can relate to this somewhat, and I've sort of talked about it here before, but so my daughter is almost three, but something about having a child and sort of the protectiveness and love that comes along with having a little person that you helped make and who is your flesh and blood, never before than in the past 2 years have I literally wept because of stories that I hear basically of crimes against children or even just crimes against the innocent, injustice, suffering, rape, torture, whatever, of just, it hits me in the heart in a way that it never did before. I mean, I think because of course, like my mind immediately goes, what if that happened to my kid? You know, I would do anything to keep Olive from that. I would do, you know, I would endure torture or be killed myself if it meant keeping her from such harm. And so there's like a very emotional protective piece behind it. That's like, it is really hard to think about the horrific things that have been done to kids and to people and try to reconcile that with a God. And at least the place that I'm at this moment, and this is even a very recent sort of realization, the only comfort I can take from that is that he would have to be good enough that the end result is so enormous and overwhelmingly good that it can actually absorb all the suffering that has ever taken place, and whatever comes after this existence that we have, all of that will be forgotten and it will be just pure bliss for those who have suffered, and that his love actually can overwhelm it. Because otherwise every other form of logic is, I mean, people so often go, why is there so much suffering in the world? Why doesn't God stop it right now? And I admit my answer even feels like a weak one to me, but it brings me some sort of strange comfort in going, there might be a level of greatness and goodness and sort of healing and restoration that goes beyond what I can even fathom.
Yeah.
And the other thing I was going to say...
Dang, well, that's been the Ink and Echo podcast from.
Hey, listen, I while you were saying that, I was reminded. I read this book recently, and it's called "The Doors of the Sea." It's by David Bentley Hart, who's a Catholic theologian. And it's kind of old, but there's this part at the end of the book. Basically, the whole point of the book is his sort of takedown of the neo-Calvinist, neo-reformed idea that if there's evil in the world, that God has allowed it. Which is kind of what you're saying, like if there's evil in the world, like how can God be good, right? And so this book, it's like a long essay essentially, is his theology of that. And it's the second to last page. He says this thing that has stuck with me for a long time, and it's what I keep coming back to when I think about these, like the tough questions. You know, like who, if God is good, then why are these things happening? And he says, if indeed there was a God whose true nature, whose justice or sovereignty were revealed in the death of a child or the dereliction of a soul or the predestination to hell, then it would be no great transgression to think of him as a kind of malevolent, contemptible demiurge, and to hate him and to deny him worship and to seek a better God than he. And
yeah,
I think about that all the time because I think it's so common for people to be like, I should specify, for evangelical Christians or Reformed Christians to think of their tradition's idea of God as cement, and like that there's only one way to understand God, who God is and what God is, and if that image bumps up against reality in a way that is uncomfortable, you just have to deal with it because that's just the way that things are, and so we're going to work really hard to like make those things make sense. Even if it's like, let me see this tragedy that happened. I think about the Newtown school shooting, right? Seeing all those kids at that school, and to hear in my mind somebody say, "Well, that's the will of God. He's being glorified through this." You would be better to leave that God and find a new one.
Or it sounds people are probably saying that stuff because they don't want to think about it. Like, that's just an easy way to be like,
right,
that's off my, I don't even have to think about that anymore. That's great.
Yeah, yeah.
This stuff makes me think, I mean, my thoughts on it, like, currently I'm pretty apathetic, if I had to use a word to describe all of this.
Yeah.
And the two things I want to say for me personally is, one, that if I'm going to believe in anything, it's going to be with a healthy, incredibly large dose of a mystery. So I don't think, I mean, currently, and again, I'm very open to me thinking something 100% different in 2 years. So I'm not holding myself to anything, but I just currently don't see a way to believe in anything like this without dealing with uncertainty and mystery. And so currently it's like, how do you deal with that? And I don't know. And then the other thing is just that, at least given, I always go back to my mental ability or non-ability, and it's just that I think like when reality and extra reality stuff collide, like I'm always going to side on reality. So it's kind of like I mentally just want to be in the world around me for right now and figure out what that means first, which, you know, that's not something you can figure out either, but it's like, okay, someone's newborn dies. Like, I'd rather just spend my energy helping that person than figuring out what it means in some cosmic sense, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I would very much, as much as I do enjoy this conversation, I'd really love to not have to have this conversation. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Well, and it's like, this is the other thing too, is like, does something like that have cosmic significance, or are there things in the universe that are meaningless, you know,
and yeah,
that chaos exists someplace.
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't know. I don't think I'll ever know the answer to that question.
Sure.
So it's like, well, I just want to focus on what's here. I want to focus on my wife and my kids and what I feel like I should do outside of that from there. And, you know, so that's why I say I'm at a really, I think I was not at an angry spot. Like, even when we were texting like a month ago or something, I was kind of just like, why? I was sort of angry at the question and angry at the inability to seemingly know anything. But for now, I'm just kind of like, I lost the energy to be angry about any of that stuff. And I'm kind of just here now. And I'm happy to have the conversation and want to have the conversation, but I just feel no pressure for anything around this stuff. And I don't, you know, I'm not going to church. I'm not even reading any books. I want to read books, but I'm not. And I don't know what that means about me or says, but that's, I don't know. That's where I'm at for this stuff, as boring as that sounds.
there's something else too to be said, I think, about like the way that our culture operates is like in a binary. So
I hate binaries.
You either believe or you don't believe, or you're either saved or you're not saved, or either there's a purpose or there isn't a purpose, or, you know, like whatever. And the reality is the universe doesn't operate in a binary. You know, there's like everything doesn't land on one side or the other. Most things don't land on one side or the other. And so it's okay to be, or in my opinion, it's okay to be like, hey man, I don't know what I think about this. I'm just going to leave it alone, you know?
Yeah. Well, it kind of is interesting when you were talking about you thinking about your previous self who used to believe things and kind of seemingly wanting to be that person again. I just, in my talking about all this stuff, I feel like the analogy of the Pandora's box is somewhat apt a lot of the time, because it's like, and it's not necessarily about knowledge. It's just about, probably about experience more than anything else. Like you have these experiences, and at least for me, it's like you're going through life and you realize someone told me this was a binary, like this is a black and white, yes or no. And then you come across a thing, you're like, oh, it's more complicated than that. And it seems like every single thing has that happen to it. And I'm like, well, you can't undo those experiences and then go back to the guy who was like, yeah, it's just, you know, gays are bad. Those are really bad people, you know? You can't go back to that after certain experiences, you know? Yeah. And I just feel like the older I get, the more things are being messed up. All the things that I was, and that's where I go back to is like, I think I just have to figure out how to be okay with that. It's not that I have to figure it out. It's just I have to figure out how to live with that fact that I'm not going to figure it out. Right. That's where I'm at going forward. I don't know.
Maybe that was what I was trying. I'm like trying to articulate and doing a poor job. I realized that like, after we had been talking for like an hour, I was like, man, I haven't articulated that well at all. But that's exactly what I feel like is there are things that like the easiest thing that I can relate it to is the way that I create art or the things that I choose to consume, right? Mm-hmm. My favorite artists are not people that give me cut and dry moral story about things. They're the people that like wrestle with the in between. And that's the things that I like create. I try and do that with also. And so that to me tells me that like that's like the truest version of who I am, if that makes sense. Like
the truest way version of humanity in general.
Yeah. But you know, Katy Perry also.
Yes. Well, that's been the Ink and Echo podcast. I'm just
kidding. So two thoughts, and I'll probably forget the second one.
Write them down real quick.
Maybe start with number two, and then go to, I don't know.
I was just going to say, Andy, hearing what you just explained, I'm going to go out on a limb and say you can probably live your life that way without having to search for an answer. I'd say Dave and I are probably more the types that we can't just pretend that is not present. Like, okay, I'll just speak for myself. Sorry, Dave.
You like, son of a bitch. You dragging me down with you.
You just hang up the call and leave the podcast and like throw something. Anyway, in a sense, Andy, I envy you that you don't think about it as much, or that you're able to operate without having to think so hard. But
well, and I'm not saying I don't. I'm burned out on the cognitive dissonance of it. And it'll surely come back. The pendulum is always swinging. So there's that.
Okay. Fair enough. Yeah. I think at least my personality, I can't go to work. I can't be a husband or a dad. I can't do anything creative without at least some level of peace, and like doesn't have to mean absolute truth, but just something to land on to be like, okay, I think at least for right now that makes sense, because otherwise it's just constant churning of thought. And you know, obviously that comes with very bad days kind of basically panic attacks or getting very stuck in my own head and you know, just being all over the map.
Yeah, that's interesting.
So, but I also think, isn't it, to use the word again, like, Andy, you do think in a very binary way, to where I think at least the attitude that I hear from you now is the thing it would take to get you to believe in God would have to be like he shows up at your doorstep and kicks you on your ass. Like you're asking for something very concrete. And I totally believe that Christianity should involve a big element of mystery. And I think we've all here been disenchanted with Christians who act as if they have all the answers, because that's just very arrogant and it's just not true. And, it's not a practical way to live your life as if you have a solid answer for everything. So all that to say, your mention of mystery, I hope that is always a part of my faith journey.
Yeah.
That I will never fully really land on something so solid other than right. the sort of foundational pieces.
Would you say, Josh, that you, so I think I agree with you when you spoke for me, saying that that we are looking for answers or whatever it was that you said. Right. But I think at the end of the day, for me, I am okay saying, like, and this is regardless of whether I feel like I found an answer or not, saying maybe, but probably not. You know what I mean? Does that make sense? So, one of the first things that happened for me in my, this is before even any of this started to happen, one of the first things that I had to question for my own belief system was what happens after we die, and is hell real and eternal punishment, or is there something else, right? And so I've come to a point where I feel like I have a pretty strong understanding of what the Bible teaches about that, and I can have a conversation with any, you know, Christian about that topic and feel like I could present my findings and say, here's why I'm right and you're wrong. But at the end of the day, the caveat is also, but it's probably not. It's probably something else.
Yeah.
You know, does that make sense? So, like, that's the mystery for me, is saying, like, I know what I believe, but it's probably wrong.
Yeah. Yep.
I'm down. I often sort of, end conversations with that sort of thing as well.
I'm down.
No.
Not that part.
I'm down and I don't know. I've told Emmy, my wife, multiple times, because we have a little dog that Andy is acquainted with named Toby. And I'm just like, you know, wouldn't it be nice to be a dog and you just go to sleep when you die? I mean, then you wouldn't have to worry about anything.
Wait, hold on. You don't believe that pets go to heaven?
I mean, I do believe all dogs go to heaven, but only because of that cartoon movie, and, like, clearly that's doctrine. So, but no, just that idea of, like, damn it. The moment we begin thinking, we have existential terror, or at least I did. And it's just like, man, animals, they got
so
it
jealous.
Made.
Yeah, for sure.
But
like, their purpose is clearly laid out. We just gotta get it on and get some more of these little suckers out in the world, and that's what we're gonna do.
I was just about to say animals can't make art, and so that would be bad, but can you imagine Cordial Kill made by dogs?
Think about it. That'd be,
I know it might be too late for a rewrite, but I'm gonna give you that for free.
Yes. Hey, well, that could be the sequel. Cordial Kill the Barkening. I don't know.
Ooh.
Andy, did you get off the mic? I think he had to go deal with his kids.
To be quiet.
Yeah, you yell at him good and hard.
Sorry. I'm being a bad dad and a bad podcast host at the same time.
Hey, do we have any sponsors for this episode, Josh?
Yes, we sure do. Andy, would you cue the music? I'd say it's about time. Our listeners need a little lighten okay. up in their lives. All right.
Here we go.
Ah, guys, you know, in this world we live in, we're just subject to a whole lot of profanity, a whole lot of bad words.
Damn straight.
Cuss words, curse words, bad words, profanity. Profane. There's so many names for these, and we all know all of them. And our sponsor decided that they didn't want to hear all of that badness in the world anymore.
Excellent.
So they
get it out of here. That's what I say.
because our sponsor believes the point of the world is to moralize everyone who doesn't believe what you do.
Preach it,
that's,
brother.
That's very good to happen.
Uh-huh. If we know anything about that, we all agree with that sales pitch.
Yes. We're all on the same page with that, for sure.
100.
So they've invented, speaking of dogs, it's sort of like a dog collar, actually, that you put on.
Oh.
And it's sort of metallic, but it's got a foam insert in the middle, so it's comfortable on your neck.
Mm.
And you clip this device on, and it automatically censors every possible bad word. You can program in your own settings, so you could have like a ding or a beep like you hear on the radio.
Wait. I was thinking it was going to go the opposite, or it was going to be a shock collar for when you said a bad word, like when dogs bark.
Oh no, this is
when there a setting for that?
This is assuming that you are such a good boy that you never say cuss words.
Oh, this is the right show for good boys. So that's great.
Right. So you wear this collar. And any of those bad boys or girls in the world who say bad words, this is protecting you from that negative influence.
Excellent sense.
So when you get inundated with some F-bombs.
Inundated?
Are you familiar with this term? Like, why is there a question about that?
Inundated.
This is a word.
Inundated. Or inundated.
Oh, inundated. That's sort of like the real estate thing. It's part of the country how you pronounce it.
I've never heard that
I haven't heard that either.
I've always said "said."
He's just digging a hole, digging it deeper.
Inundated. Someone once made fun of me for saying compilation instead of compilation.
Anyhow,
here's the thing.
Give me the thing.
Well, this product, I would rather that you guys guessed the name of the company before I say it. So what would you think that this this cuss proof collar, you know, what are they called?
It's the swear saver.
Dave, you got anything?
I'm thinking right now, it's a collar. But does it connect to your ears, though? Or the how does the ding...
The cuss conch.
Is it just really loud?
Necklace.
I mean, the cuss conch is correct.
No?
I'm not sure what,
are you
the,
sure
what the second word means, but it sounds right.
A puka profane puka
it's like
necklace.
It's like a... Oh, the profane puka.
It could be either of those. So how it connects to your ears is it's very advanced science and technology that just, there's no earbuds involved.
I love advanced science technology.
Electronal revelations over here.
Electronal? Yes. Hey, speaking of binaries, I love the ones and zeros in those things, you know?
Yeah. So it just sends, it pulsates electronal rhythms up your neck and into your ear drums.
Oh, that sounds like the music Dave and I make.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, the whole point of the pooky poncho or whatever is, or the cuss conch. is anyway, we just want to protect all our listeners' ears from all those bad words so they could listen while they could use it while they listen to this show. That would probably be a good idea, actually.
Yeah, especially because of Dave. He's
right.
Ugh.
Ugh.
So anyway, to hear, to look, to get some more of this,
to not hear,
to hear less words in general, go to inkineco.com/cussconch.
Is that with K's or C's?
Better do C's.
Okay, great.
Sure.
Okay. Thanks so much. That was shit.
Oh boy. There is no show like the Bad Christian Podcast, I'll tell you what.
Hey now.
Wait, what?
You're mixing your brands up. This is not our hashtag brand.
Oh boy. This isn't the Bad Christian?
No, is that what you thought you were doing?
God damn it.
Well, hey, Dave, it's been great having you on.
Wow, good accent, Andy. You should do more accents on this show.
Oh, yep. Well, Dave, what are you doing now? What's your life like now? What are you doing?
Well, now I live in Chicago. I play some music sometimes. I work a day job. I do music production and engineering the other part of the time. That's pretty much my life.
And what are your current projects, whether current producing or your own music?
Names, buddy. Give us some names.
Names? Drop those names.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Well, I'm working on an album for a band called Families. They're a folk band. This is the second album I've worked on with them, and that we just finished production. Working on the mixes now. I'm going to do two records. It's an EP and a full length for them.
Are you mixing?
I'm mixing, yeah.
Nice.
And then got an album by a solo project called Sun Baron that will be coming out soon.
Is that Trump?
Yeah, we don't say that word here.
Baron Trump?
Where's the profanity collar? I need that.
Is that that's oh boy, I don't want to go here, actually.
That's an undesired word, at least.
And then I'm working on my own solo record right now, too, for my stuff.
Which is called Naal. Is that how you pronounce Naal. It? N-A-L. Yeah. N-A-A-L.
Yep, Naal.
Okay.
And that'll be out sometime. It's been a long process. Great.
The old sometime.
The old sometime.
Great.
And where, David, can people find your things on the interweb?
You can go to, if you want to find my music, you can go to naalmusic.com. That is N-A-A-L and then music.com. You can go to brokenlightrecords.com. That will get you information on all of my music production stuff. And you can find my old podcast there, too.
Oh, it's because it shows up on iTunes, but you can't actually play anything through iTunes anymore. Is that true? I thought I tried once. Maybe I'm wrong.
Huh.
But it's on the website, if nothing else.
It's on the website, yeah. If you go to brokenlightrecords.com and then you click the button that says show, you can find my podcast there.
Great.
Yeah.
And maybe someday I'll finally be allowed to be a guest. Shit.
Or maybe this is as close as you're going to get.
Oh, yeah. We just had to make Dave a guest on our show so that I could I'd been on the...
You just had to make your own podcast to get back at him. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, yeah. Everybody, this has been a real great...
Are you happy with this, Dave? Are you okay? Are we good?
Yeah, this is... I didn't know what we were going to talk about getting in, and I feel like I'm going to listen back and maybe... maybe just Bizon, you know what I'm saying? Like maybe just be like,
you're going to ask us to take it down?
Yeah, you'll be the second Dave guys. To do that.
Oh,
I got to...
What if we have a Dave curse on this podcast? We just
that'd be really interesting.
They all want it. Who? What other Daves could we have on that would not
Dave, Matthews
Chappelle?
Ooh. Oh yeah, good
Dave
ones.
Chappelle.
Let's see, David Cronenberg.
Crowder.
David
Crowder.
He's in our demographic. Absolutely. Nope.
Why? Because he's a white guy?
Nope.
Indy, because we love hashtag worship music.
Yeah. Here. Where's that necklace? I need it for that.
Soderbergh? David Soderbergh?
Yeah.
No, that? Steven Soderbergh.
Steven. Whoops. David Fincher.
Lynch.
Mm. I don't know any Daves. You guys are doing great, though.
If the Wendy's founder was still alive, we'd talk to him.
Mm. Is his name Dave?
Dave Thomas.
Dave Wendy's?
Dave Wendy.
Okay, we better get out of here before
Why? I like
our
this.
Listeners start unsubscribing.
My kids are yelling at each other downstairs. It doesn't matter. I've got my second beer. It's fine. I think Dave should bring us out.
Well, guys, thanks for listening to the Ink and Echo podcast. If you like, comment, subscribe. See you all. See you all next time.
10:00 Wow.
I got a tugboat going past.
Wait, hold on.
I can't trying to that. Harmonize them.
Oh, they're right off. Is yours empty? Mine's empty.
Mine is empty.
Do you have one, Dave?
Get it's the just water. Fuck down to Farmer. See, it'd have to be something. Have to be something else. Who'd be the third brother?
Billy blowing bottles here. He's a big old bitch. Billy blowing bottles is my brother. I was gonna ask for a stinger, but I think we got it.
He'd be the brother who would do like a chili cook-off at the state fair, and he would just yell at everybody walking past and be like, "Hey, bitch, get over here. try some of my goddamn fire chili."
Oh, man.
Oh, boy. What a show we have here.